cases of kidnapping and abductions in Nigeria appear to be getting worse, according to government reports documenting the only reported cases of about 937 people who were being kidnapped in Kaduna State alone. Now, in the first quarter of 2021, 949 persons were kidnapped, again, as reported by the government. But it appears to be emerging as millions of naira are being paid by abductors by the family of the victim. The South used the reports. They reported the highest number of kidnappings as militants in Bayelsa, Delta, and River State targeted all expatriates. Remember that. In the Southwest, 264 people were kidnapped between 2018 and May 2020, according to media reports. The case is obviously getting out of hand, and even family members of leaders and politicians are now being targeted. So the question is, what is the remedy? Well, joining us to discuss this is Dickson Osajie. He's a security expert. Dickson, it's so good to have you join us.
Thank you for having me, Amir, on.
Yes. For a second there, we thought that, you know, we had some, reprieve of sorts with the issues of kidnappings and, you know, banditry. But it seems to become, a thriving business of sorts. And more of these kidnappings are happening. You and I have had conversations as to why government has not dealt with this situation. Recently, the National Assembly has reached out to Mr. President to ask him to change the nomenclature of these so-called bandits to terrorists because of their activities. And we're yet to hear from Mr. President on that particular matter. So I ask you, as a security person who's working within the country, who's seen all that's been happening in the country, what do you think the remedy is to deal with this situation?
Thank you very much. It's a worrisome situation, and I must confess that kidnapping is taking the light of the day. We, as the country, we did not, attack this. Let me just the kidnap market. You know, before now, the spate of robbery has been flourishing in Nigeria, but at the arrest of Evans, the kidnapper, a lot of people can bring more money, you know. Or to look from that period of time, the spate of armed robbery reduced, and guys began to go into kidnapping because they got to know that Evans made a lot of billions. And that was one of the errors from the Nigerian police PRO. You know, sometimes when they get most of these armed robbers and these criminals, they will parade them in the public. They will hax these criminals to demonstrate how they carry out their criminal activities. That is an erroneous process by the police system. So that was where kidnap took the boom. The kidnap market took the boom because the risk implication in kidnapping, Mary Ann, is very low compared to the risk implication in robbery. So going back to what is happening in the northwest and the northeast, most of these guys have seen that they can no longer be walking in the desert. You know, if I can pick somebody up and make about 200 or 300 million naira or 20 million, that can fetch me more than 100 cattle. So the cattle market is no longer interesting to me. That is the problem we have here in Nigeria. So if you want to ask me, why has the president not proscribed, or the government not proscribed the bandits as terrorist group? Mary Ann, terrorism has no universal acceptable definition. Are you with me? The person you call terrorist today could see himself as a freedom fighter. So the reason why the government has not named them terrorists, I don't know, but naming them terrorists is not the way forward. Boko Haram has been named terrorists many years ago. See, today they are still messing up the name of Nigeria in the international community.
But I'm thinking, because most people are pushing for the nomenclature change is maybe that the government would be able to deal with it as it is, as opposed to saying, oh, killer herdsmen or known gunmen. And we have so many names out there. Maybe it could be the reason why the government is not pushing as hard as it should. Maybe it could also be the reason why there's some politicization of, you know, handling this issue in the first instance. This is my thoughts. I'm just wondering. But aside from the name change, Governors like the governor of Benue State has been very vocal as to, you know, these issues of kidnappings and banditry. I mean, we even saw these people go into the NDA. We have seen them capture leaders of thought. We've seen family members of, you know, politicians being taken, and some of them end up dead. So again, what needs to happen? Because I just reeled out numbers of people who've been kidnapped over the years. What needs to happen for government's hand to be forced to deal with this issue head on? Now, we're not making light of the fact that we have soldiers who are working night and day to keep our borders safe. But what more do we need to happen for something to happen? Because you see, as we speak, yesterday we were mulling over the statement of the AGF on calling on a state of emergency of sorts, and they're contemplating it for Anambra. Why? There's an election coming up in November. Why can't we do that in the Mary south, Ann, in the northwest, and in the northeast?
Mary Ann, please, the comment from the AGF is sickening. I sometimes I wonder if it's a trained lawyer, because you cannot just come on air and say you want to prescribe, you want to set up a state of emergency in the southeast. What is the threat level in the southeast? What is the risk implication in the southeast? We have Boko Haram that has placed us in the third, as the third most affected terrorist state in the nation in the world. We've not seen them, setting a state of emergency in the northeast. They are still running their government there without state of emergency. If there's any state that needs a state of emergency, I will advise the government to go for Kaduna State, Zamfara State, Katsina State, Borno State, Yobe State, and these states are most of the states that are hit by terrorism. Now, let's come back to terrorism studies. You know, in terrorism, these guys, what makes them to flourish is publicity. And first of all, let me tell you the truth, Mary Ann, because the best thing you can do for your country is to tell your country the truth. The reason why we arrive at this stage is a failure of our leaders. They've made the labor of our heroes past to be in vain, because there's a line in the national anthem that said the labor of our heroes past shall never be in vain. But since 1999, our leaders from 1999 have worked so hard to ensure that the labors of our heroes past is really in vain, because they've really messed up this great nation. Corruption, embezzlement, lack of unemployment, religious brutality, police brutality, nepotism brutality, ethnocentric brutality. Leadership failure has given birth to the spirit of insecurity here in Nigeria. Until our leaders go back to the drawing board and are ready to lead us aright, and let us know that, hey guys, we are ready to lead you guys. Because if you are bought the social contract, this is what you get. We've suffered so much from the breach of social contract. Our leaders has breached that social contract. What does the social contract entail? The leaders are supposed to give us good governance. They're supposed to give us education. They're supposed to give our youth jobs. They're supposed to give us good roads, electricity. And we're not having all these things. And they want the Nigerian people to be obedient, to be law-abiding. It doesn't work anywhere. Social contract must be respected. If peradventure we've been upholding the social contract between the confines of Nigeria, the state of insecurity won't have risen to this state. Mary Ann, 2 years ago, some hoodlums went to the National Assembly. They cut away the mace of the National Assembly. Nothing happened to today. That tells you that our leaders are not ready to defend this great nation. So for us to go back to the drawing board and ensure that we have a good nation, our leaders must begin to think aright and ensure that they lead us with all honesty.
Now, of course, the elections are getting close. We might just see a bit more seriousness on the part of our leaders. I was speaking to a lawyer some days ago, and he sounded more like the government knows what to do, but they choose when to do it. Is this not a disservice to the soldiers who have died in the forefront of fighting this, insurgents and the terrorists that, you know, are pervading our society every day? Is this not a disservice to the Nigerians who the politicians swore to protect and serve? Is this not a disservice to the mothers whose children have been taken away? And let's not forget, most of these children are still in custody, have become wives of these terrorists. These same terrorists have also come back with placards saying that we should forgive them, and the government, including the army, is contemplating to reintegrate them into society. What does this say, generally, about this country?
What this is trying to let us know about Nigeria is that Nigeria is not serious. Our leaders must be held accountable. If anything goes wrong in Nigeria, I personally, Dickson Osajie, I am disappointed at our leaders. You know, they fail to understand that as leaders, they are supposed to be role model. Maybe, and like you rightly said in your questioning, frankly speaking, it is a total disservice to our heroes past. It's a total disservice to our soldiers. It's a total disservice to our military, our police, our security agents that are putting their life on the line to uphold the sovereignty of Nigeria. Our soldiers are dying every day, Mary Ann. Our police are dying every day. And our leaders, our politicians are busy embezzling our funds. They are busy engaging our youth to go and fight against themselves. And 2023 is around the corner. Nigerian youth, listen very carefully. You saw what happened about a politician, Femi Panikade, having, blattered our president, blattered some other people. He has decamped to the APC. I'm not against his decampment, but what I'm trying to say is that these politicians, they are all one. Let us also come as one. Let's not kill ourselves for any politicians. Let's not kill ourselves for any leaders. Let us stand in unity to ensure that we move Nigeria forward, because truly, Mary Ann, all what is happening is a total disservice to the sovereignty of Nigeria. And our leaders, they know what to do. They know what to do very right. What is happening to the technological application to our military? We are still operating a military system in which our soldiers are falling ambush, getting ambushed by this insurgent every day, dying in numbers. Our soldiers are training so hard and they are dying cheap. As a soldier, you're supposed to train hard and die hard. But in this 21st century, Nigerian soldiers are training so hard and regrettably they are dying so cheap because our leaders have failed to uphold the territorial integrity of this great nation. They have refused to ensure that they are supposed to serve this nation with all honesty and truthfulness. If anything happens to this great nation, we must hold our leaders responsible. The reason why we have arrived at this stage is the long-time failure of leadership. If, for example, we have good leaders in this great nation, I don't think this better security would have risen. We have our leaders traveling from their various states to London, United Kingdom, United States, to go and carry out a medical checkup. Is it not a shame that you are going to another country to go and enjoy good governance? That is a total shame to you. If you have good leaders, you're supposed to remain in your state, put in infrastructure in place. If you are having headache or malaria, go to your state hospital and get yourself treated. But when you leave your state to go to another country to go and enjoy the good governance of that country, you are a total failure to your state. So for me, our leaders must push themselves from reality. They must come back to the drawing board and ensure that Nigeria at 61, the labor of our heroes past must not be in vain.
Dickson Osajie is a security expert. Thank you very much for speaking with us. We're hoping that going forward, the situation will change for the better. Thank you.
I pray so. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you all for staying with us. We hope you enjoyed the program. Before we leave you, I want to say, don't forget you can watch a playback of this show on our YouTube channel. Yes, at Plus TV Africa and Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. Go follow us and subscribe. We're also on Instagram and on Facebook. I am Mary Anakon. I'll see you next week, Monday. We'll leave you with a recap of what we had been speaking about this week. We hear people say that the government doesn't care. These bodies are piling up and they become numbers. But what do you think the challenge is? Why do you think that disconnect is there between the presidency and what Nigerians are saying or they're feeling?
I think that among other things, there seems to be an absence of a strategy for engaging Nigerian people. This president, has his own style. And I think that his health has not helped matters, and I think we need to take cognizance of that. But you could easily have bridged that gap by empowering other institutions and organs of communication. And what I see, unfortunately, and for me this is one of the greatest tragedies, that what I see is almost constantly, the president is almost like fighting, you know, with citizens. The speech is full of warnings and so on and so forth.
Every time there are issues within the political parties, we're going to find as many as 3-4 different conflicting judgments of the court that comes out in record time. But when it is about human rights, you find the same judiciary slow walking, and then the case is staying 2 years in court and the person is not seeing any judge. There are over 300 Nigerians in Kirikiri, for instance, arrested since the immediate aftermath of Endsars. None of them has been taken before any judge to be tried. 11, this is the 12th month. 12th month. And there is a judiciary. So exactly how independent or effective is that judiciary?
Now, you look at our media organizations on the African continent and indeed in Nigeria, and you look at the resources that we have to do investigative journalism. I mean, this the whole effort was put together by International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, ICIJ. The media in Nigeria really is struggling as far as funds are concerned, and investigative journalism is not cheap. I mean, I get people calling into my radio program to give me information, and then to the next thing they say, Mary, and you're aware of this because we hosted a morning radio program for many years together, and they would say, oh, you're an investigative journalist, go and investigate. And then I'll say, hey, excuse me, hold on, you think it's free to investigate? You think I can just stand up and go? You know, people go to war zones and they have people. How many journalists have life insurance? How many journalists are working in organizations where their basic Medicare, their HMO is even guaranteed, taken care of? So it is not cheap. We're not doing enough, but Nigerian journalists are doing the best they can.
Fine and well, you're telling me that this is an agitation, but I'm trying to understand the part of the agitation where you kill your brother, you destroy your own businesses, you destroy buildings and facilities that are in your communities to help your people. I'm trying to understand how this types of agitation would help your cause.
Yeah, what is happening in that killing, you know, in any, just like when they had Endsars, some criminals cashed in on that and hijacked Endsars and gave it a criminal coloration. The same thing with the agitation that is going on, creating a siege environment. And some people went to bring in some other people from outside the Southeast that are perfecting the killing.
Who are these people who went to bring other people outside the Southeast?
Well, by what we had from the investigation going on, the people who are the assassins are not Igbos. They are not Igbo people. You know, people are hired from outside the Southeast to settle some scores, sometimes business, sometimes politics. So, but the truth of the matter is that the agitation has created a siege environment in the Southeast.
It is the responsibility of the president to impose, not the attorney general. So the attorney general to now assume the duties of the president shows something is certainly wrong. Yeah, I do not know whether he's the proper and fit person to hold that office. And by the way, the Attorney General is a member of the Anguilla Campaign Council. That is very unusual. The duty, the office of the Attorney General is a sacred trust. It's one of the few public offices created directly by the Constitution and named by the Constitution and written in the Constitution. You cannot dabble into local politics. Let alone being a member of the gubernatorial council of any state.